All right, just give me. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. My name is Rida Tanbir, and I shall be your moderator for today's event. We shall begin our event with the keynote speaker, the Ambassador of Pakistan to Afghanistan, His Excellency Mansoor Ahmed Khan. He has recently served as the Ambassador of Pakistan to Austria and a permanent representative of Pakistan to United Nations in Vienna. Welcome, sir, and we shall begin the event with your speech, sir.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamu alaikum. First of all, I want to thank all of you for this opportunity for me for presenting my thoughts and my views about the humanitarian diplomacy and about Pakistan's continuing efforts for bringing lasting peace and stability to Afghanistan. So let me briefly give a rundown of how Pakistan-Afghanistan relations are, what are Pakistan's interests in terms of peace and stability in Afghanistan, and what is Pakistan currently doing in terms of humanitarian effort, and then taking this humanitarian effort towards an engagement which leads to lasting peace and stability in Afghanistan and regional connectivity in a region which has been marked by conflict, warfare for a long time. Pakistan and Afghanistan are two very close neighbors. Actually, it is a very unique relationship. You will not find any other two countries with the same kind of relationship. We have 2,600 kilometer long border. People on both sides of the border share common religion, common culture, common history, common geography. And the relationship for history, for centuries has been such that if peace and stability is affected in one country, the other country is bound to be affected. If there is peace and stability in Afghanistan, Pakistan will have peace, stability, and prosperity. And if it is otherwise, then Pakistan will be negatively affected. Now, a change occurred in Afghanistan, as all of us have seen on 15th August. The regime which was here under US and NATO forces for past two decades disappeared, vanished. And since the previous regime left and the new regime took power, a lot of displacements took place. Many people who were working for the past regime left, and United States imposed a freeze on Afghanistan. This led to supply routes there is shortage of supplies even in normal winters also. But this winter, this year, the winter is coming at a time when this change occurred in Afghanistan. Afghanistan's interaction with the international community has been affected. And as all of you know, Afghanistan is a landlocked country. And most of the supplies for Afghanistan, for Afghan people, for Afghans, come through borders of other countries or through air routes. But most of these routes, land routes and air routes have been affected because of this instability in Afghanistan. Now, in order to help Afghan people, support Afghan people, the international community has launched a humanitarian effort. Pakistan is at the forefront of that humanitarian effort. And we are assisting this humanitarian effort for ensuring the essential supplies, continuity of essential supplies to the people of Afghanistan, basically in two ways. One, Pakistan is sending lot of humanitarian assistance or relief goods to Afghanistan on its own. And secondly, we are helping in humanitarian supplies by international community, by UN, by other countries, by in the other international organizations. And this process, there also Pakistan is among Afghanistan's neighbors. Pakistan is acting as a focal point for Afghanistan's humanitarian assistance. Pakistan in its own supplies so far in last few weeks has already sent 1,100 metric tons of relief goods. And this relief goods comprises various commodities, food commodities, wheat, flour, cooking oil, rice, lentils, pulses, and essential medicines. In addition, and these supplies have been brought to Afghanistan through air route. A number of C-130 aircrafts have brought these supplies to Kabul, Mazar-Sharif, and Kandahar airports, and even one plane landed in Khost. But in addition to that, we are also providing these supplies through our land routes, because as I mentioned in my remarks, that Pakistan and Afghanistan have a long border. So we are supplying these, we are ensuring this flow of these supplies through Torkham and through Chaman, which are the two major border points between the two countries. In addition to Pakistan government undertaking this effort, and Pakistan government is undertaking this effort through Afghanistan-Pakistan Cooperation Forum. Afghanistan-Pakistan Cooperation Forum has been formed especially in order to ensure continuity of these humanitarian supplies. But in addition to this government effort, a number of organizations from the civil sector, from the philanthropic sector in Pakistan are also involved. For example, I want to tell you with great pride that Al Khobab Foundation, one of the civil sector organizations in Pakistan, is engaged in sending supplies to Afghanistan in humanitarian field in a big manner. Al Khidmat is another institution which is offering lot of supplies, lot of humanitarian relief goods supply to Afghanistan. We are also launching our appeals, and we are also in touch with other organizations like Hamdard or ED Foundation to come forward and play their role. So in the coming months, as Afghanistan will be passing through a winter, and as I told you that winter is really a tough season for the people of Afghanistan. So I think Pakistan government and Pakistan's this philanthropic sector, civil society organizations will be playing a great role in that. Then Pakistan's this entire effort, how Pakistan's entire effort is moving towards ensuring stability in Afghanistan in the longer term is that, you see, for last two decades, since US and NATO forces came in, Pakistan has been engaged in a peace diplomacy with Afghanistan, wherein our position has been that there is no military solution to the Afghan conflict, and there has to be a political process, a political settlement for bringing all Afghan sections of the society together in order to end this internal warfare, which has continued for past more than four decades. Now, this peace diplomacy was moving. US and Taliban had signed an agreement. Unfortunately, the Afghan elements, Afghan political forces could not come to a single, to a political solution. Therefore, Taliban took over Afghanistan's control on 15th of August. But now our efforts have continued towards a very constructive engagement with Afghanistan in the humanitarian field at present. And I have given you an overview of how our humanitarian effort has worked, is working, and will continue to work. And then we want to take this engagement into an era of economic connectivity with Afghanistan and regional connectivity with Afghanistan. Pakistan has more than 2,600 kilometer long border with Afghanistan. And therefore there is a lot of potential for connecting Pakistan's trading routes with Afghanistan and through Afghanistan with Central Asia. And now when lasting peace and stability returns to Afghanistan, and there is strengthening in this environment of security, environment of peace and stability, Pakistan can connect its ports like Gwadar, Karachi, Port Qasim, and these trading routes, which Pakistan has already been developing in the last few years under CPEC also, with Afghanistan, and through Afghanistan, through rail and road connections, through energy pipelines with Central Asian countries. And it will bring hopefully a lot of peace, progress, and prosperity to a region which has been mired in the conflict for more than last four decades. We believe that Pakistan, having this important geographical and people-to-people connectivity, can play an important role in terms of assisting Afghanistan, in terms of connecting with Afghanistan in trade and transit, and also for that purpose. For example, Pakistan has been, since 2010, Pakistan has been providing annually scholarships to Afghan students, both boys and girls, in Pakistani universities and colleges, in Pakistani higher education institutions. And these scholarships are very popular among the youth in Afghanistan. Last year, every year we provide 1,000 scholarships. Last year, when we took a test for young, you can understand, you can see how big is the demand for than 50,000 of Afghans who have received education in Pakistan in past few decades, either through scholarships or on their own, through their own finances. More than 50,000 of them are working in Afghanistan's public sector and private sector institutions. So this is the kind of connectivity between the two societies, which we believe that which should be now used for harnessing the economic potential for mutual benefit of the two countries, because it will, if Afghanistan becomes prosperous, if Afghanistan's trading routes connectivity is developed with Central Asia and Eurasia, it will bring prosperity, peace, prosperity, progress to people of Afghanistan, and it will open new avenues of economic growth for people of Pakistan. So we believe that through our partners, including China, Russia, even Western countries, United States, Turkey, Qatar, and other Afghanistan's neighbors, Iran, Central Asian countries, we can transform, we can collectively transform into regional connectivity. I would end my remarks here by saying that a better future for Afghanistan, it means a better future for Pakistan, and means a better future for the entire region. And we will be continuing our efforts in this regard. I will end it here. And if there are any further interventions required by me, I would wait for that. And I would like to listen to other panelists here also about their views.
Thank you so much, Your Excellency, for the wonderful remarks and for the wonderful lecture that you have provided to our young students over here. Indeed, whatever you have said is of great significance to the country at large. And indeed, you are right that a couple of weeks ago, I was at a summer school, which is basically a coordination between the two countries, Pakistan and Afghanistan, and Afghan students over there were really grateful to the government of Pakistan for providing them scholarship in a safe environment, sir, where they can get education without fearing for their lives. And especially the women, sir, the girls, they were really grateful for the fact that they had a safe, and they did not want to even return, sir, but that was actually the sad part, that they don't want to go back to their country, sir. And indeed, the situation in Afghanistan coming to a peaceful, end is really important, not only for Afghanistan itself, sir, but the region at large. Because if Afghanistan is peaceful and it is secure, then obviously Pakistan will have a peaceful environment as well, because we share the largest border with Afghanistan, the Durand Line, sir. And if we can have peace in Afghanistan, I'm sure peace will be prevalent in Pakistan as well. Thank you again, sir, for your lecture. The floor is open for any questions if any student wants to ask. There are any questions? Yes, sir. If there are any questions, please go ahead and ask. I take it, sir, we have a very scholarly kind of an audience, which is quite...
Already convinced.
Yeah, it's convinced, and it is very much, you can say, knowledgeable on the issue that they don't even have a single question. Atiq, if you have any question, or Musawwar, you may ask, because the audience is very quiet.
Any observations?
Yeah.
Am I audible? Can you hear me?
All right. Yes, you're audible. Please go ahead.
Yes, I do not have any question, but I would like to thank our ambassador, His Excellency.
Yes, yes, we can hear you. Please ask.
Yes, I do not have any question. I just want to thank His Excellency Ambassador Mansoor Ahmad Khan for joining us today. And Pakistan's efforts are commendable regarding humanitarian assistance to Afghanistan. And I am following the developments, what Pakistan is doing regarding humanitarian assistance, as Excellency said, by providing medicines, food, to, you know, through trucks and through C-130s. So Pakistan is playing a very vital role in sustainable peace and prosperity in Afghanistan. And we are also taking refugees from Afghanistan as well. So we need to show this to the world as well, that what Pakistan is doing. And this is our job, this is our responsibility to tell the world about the humanitarian assistance, because people just speak, countries just speak, but we are doing it practically and in the form of providing humanitarian assistance to Afghanistan even after the fall of Kabul. So this is a good gesture for the world to see the positive picture of Pakistan. And we shall continue to provide as much as possible assistance to people of Afghanistan, inshallah. Thank you very much, Excellency, again for joining us.
Actually, sir, it's raining here in Islamabad, and probably that is why there is some sort of disruption in the signals, due to which I think the voices of our participants are not really much audible for you, sir. So we apologize for that.
Yeah, but I just want to underline one important thing, that it is, I first of all appreciate that you as youth in the educational institutions, you people are actually future of Pakistan, you people represent the future of the region. You are taking interest in these issues, and it is important that youth of the two countries should also start their exchanges with each other, should engage more and more on the issues relating to education, issues relating to economic progress and connectivity, issues relating to trade, transit, and development. And Afghan youth are actually, Afghan people in general and Afghan youth are inclined to have, they desire to have contacts between Pakistan and Afghanistan. And the most favored place which they visit or in large numbers, the Afghans and Afghan youth visit, is Pakistan. And therefore, visas from our embassy and our consulates in Afghanistan. And this also reflects the kind of deep bonds of connectivity that the people of the two countries have. So I think this is an opportunity. International community on the issues like making the government more inclusive, bringing human rights, attaching importance to human rights, particularly women rights and participation of women in education, employment, and other things. And then through this political stability agenda, move to economic progress and connectivity. Pakistan's policy at the moment is the focus of Pakistan's relations abroad, or Pakistan's foreign policy is on geoeconomics. And for geoeconomics, Afghanistan provides us the first place of regional connectivity because of the close bonds we have with Afghan people, because of the long border we have with Afghan people. So I think I appreciate, as youth, you have been taking interest in these matters, and I will encourage you and will be ready to assist in any matter if there is any kind of exchange required.
Your Excellency, there are a couple of questions, if it's okay, I'll ask. They're from the audience, sir. The first question is from Amon Jamil, and she's saying that if Pakistan is doing a lot for the purpose of peace in the region, then why Western world is putting sanctions on us? The first question, should I say the other one, or do you want to answer this one first?
Well, you can ask both questions and then I can respond one by one.
All right, sir. So the other one is, Pakistan's Achilles heel is its economy's abject dependence on foreign debt, arising out of the import intensity of production sector as well as consumption. Pakistan rupee is flying higher and we are still committed to accomplish others. Why Pakistan's policy is flexible in between taking aid from IMF and State Bank and giving aid to neighbor countries? Would you like to highlight the structure? And another question is that, as we know that Afghanistan has suffered a lot during recent decades, now what will be the golden steps taken by Pakistan to support a stable government in Afghanistan, and how Pakistan will bring CPEC and BRI projects for development in Afghanistan, sir?
I think I attend to or address all these questions. For number one, as regards Pakistan's role in peace and stability in Afghanistan, I think the factual position is that all the members of the international community have appreciated the role Pakistan has played. And in fact, Pakistan embassy provided a lot of assistance to all these countries, United States and other Western countries and other countries of the region, when this happened, when this change happened on 15th August, and there was an evacuation phase that was underway from 15th August to 31st of August, when US and NATO forces were withdrawing, and when many countries, embassies and personnel from international organizations were moving out of Afghanistan. Pakistan actually assisted them in moving out of Afghanistan, coming to Pakistan, coming to other places. Some of the organizations, because of the uncertainty in Afghanistan, wanted to relocate their people in Pakistan. And we actually continue to provide that assistance even now. There has been a section in the international community, in the United States also, which has been arguing which has been criticizing Pakistan and arguing for sanctions or other kind of punitive measures. But that does not reflect the voice of the international community. That is a very minor section which has always been engaged in a kind of propaganda against Pakistan. So I think the countries who are present here now, we are having interaction with them, with the UN in Kabul, and all of them are appreciating Pakistan's role in humanitarian effort, in bringing engagement with Afghan Taliban, and in engagement with in providing engagement with Afghan society. The second question was about the kind of trade and transit and economic context. Yes, Pakistan has been dependent on foreign aid in past few decades. But focus of Pakistan now is on harnessing its potential. We are sitting in a region where regional connectivity can provide us so many opportunities for trade, transit, and connectivity. So many opportunities for enhancing our economic growth through these activities, rather than depending upon IMF aid or World Bank aid or aid from other countries. So I think self-sustainability, self-dependence, depending on our own resources, depending on our own capabilities, should be the policy for us and for our coming generations in the coming decades. And I think Afghanistan provides an opportunity for starting this wave of this phase of the regional economic connectivity, bringing some important extending this BRI, the Chinese project of Belt and Road Initiative. Growth only our own that situation of Afghanistan in terms of security and peace stability has been relatively